What I'm going to go through now originally was known as the fluvial cycle of erosion. It was something that was created by a very famous fluvial geomorphologist named William Morris Davis at UC Berkeley back in the beginning of the 20th century. But there were some problems with his model. Nevertheless, a number of the terms that he used to describe the way the landscape changes as a result of running water happen to be the terms that we still use. So I'm not going to present it as if it's the fluvial cycle of erosion, but I'm going to go through what the basic premise of this model is and talk to you about the terminology that we still use today. So here we go. If you take a look at this diagram that I built over here on the right-hand side, right there, let's assume that that is, for example, a mountain range, and that the two gray arrows indicate tectonic uplift. So in other words, this is a tectonically active landscape. When you have a tectonically active landscape and there's uplift in the area, that uplift is, of course, going to increase the slope of the landscape. And when you increase the slope of the landscape, you're going to increase the velocity at which the water flows across the surface. In addition, by uplifting the landscape, there may be increased discharge as well because of orographic lifting of air masses, right? So this is what's happening. This is the basic premise of what's happening, is that you have a tectonically active landscape. The landscape's being uplifted. That's going to increase slope on the landscape, which is going to increase velocity of water. When the landscape is uplifted, what begins to happen is this. The primary action of runoff in steep landscapes is incision. Just like if you watch these medical shows or whatever on TV or fake medical shows, and you'll see that the doctor will take a scalpel and make an incision in a human being, they cut into them, or these four sharp teeth in your mouth are called your incisors or canine teeth because they tear into things. So too, what happens in a steep landscape is the primary action of running water is to slice downwards into the landscape. In other words, to incise the landscape. That action of incision, which you can see with the blue arrow pointing downwards, that action of incision by the running water, by the runoff, creates the classic mountain river valley that's named after the letter in the alphabet that it most resembles. What letter of the alphabet do you see imprinted on that landscape, that fake landscape that I'm creating there in light blue? That would be V. Very good. Because of that, the classic river valley is known as a V-shaped valley. You're going to see how that comes back when I talk about glaciers, because one of the ways that we use to distinguish what has happened on the landscape is we look at the shape of the valley. If the valley is V-shaped, this is a river valley. If it's U-shaped, like the letter U, in most cases, that means a glacier went through that valley. Okay? Good. I also want you to see this as you look at this diagram. Remember, the tectonic processes and the gradational processes are working in opposition to each other. So you can see if you look at the arrows, the gray arrows pointing upwards indicate tectonic movement, whereas that blue arrow is gradational processes. It indicates that the landscape is being worn down. So one thing's uplifting, the other thing is wearing down. This is always what's happening with the tectonic and gradational processes on this planet. They are operating in opposition to each other. Where is that running water going to? Well, the running water, the runoff, is attempting to cut the landscape down to base level. Base level is the lowest level to which a stream can erode. Global base level is sea level, but local base level is the level of a lake, or can be the level of a lake. So when you're looking at this, that blue arrow is going down towards that black line along the bottom of the diagram. The black line represents base level, whether that's local base level and it's a lake or whether it's global base level. This is where the running water is attempting to get down to. As it does that on a steep landscape, it cuts this V-shaped river valley. This is the Grand Canyon of the Yellowstone in Yellowstone National Park, and the river that's flowing through there in the middle is the Yellowstone River. This river valley is a classic V-shaped valley, which means the river cut this valley. Now, in a tectonically passive landscape, so a place where the tectonic processes are no longer active, or they haven't been active for a very long time, the landscape tends to be flat. And in a flat, tectonically passive landscape, the primary action of a river, rather than incise the landscape, tends to be to cut back and forth, side by side across the landscape, creating a kind of lateral or horizontal erosion and degradation. Additionally, in flat landscapes, as we went through before, meandering streams tend to be the type of water that flows across the landscape. You've seen this diagram before, and you're going to see it again. This is a diagram of a meandering stream. But now, if you look at this, you can see the blue arrow with the arrowheads pointing both directions. It's indicating that as that meandering stream goes back and forth across the landscape, its primary action is to cut horizontally rather than incise the landscape. You can see where it says bluffs, it's cutting back and forth, going to those bluffs and cutting away the landscape from side to side rather than vertically. This, of course, is the Fox River again in northern Illinois, flat landscape, and look at what the river's doing. It cuts back and forth across the landscape as meandering streams do, and meandering streams tend to be found on flat landscapes. Okay, now look what just showed up. The gray arrows showed up, and the gray arrows indicate uplift. If you have a flat landscape and a meandering stream, and the tectonic processes reemerge, and the landscape once again gets uplifted like this, we call that process rejuvenation, like making the landscape young again. So rejuvenation occurs in areas that were tectonically passive, but have now become tectonically active, and uplift once again begins to dominate the landscape. If uplift dominates the landscape, that's going to make the landscape steeper. It's going to increase the slope. Increasing the slope increases velocity. And what happens to the river is it switches from the back and forth across the landscape, horizontal, side by side, lateral, cutting away the landscape, and it returns to incision, cutting down into the landscape. If you have a meandering stream on that landscape and it gets uplifted, the primary action of the river is going to be incision, to cut downwards rather than back and forth. The result of that is that it creates what's called entrenched meanders, which you can see here that I've highlighted in white. Entrenched meanders are steep-sided meandering canyons that are formed in an area where there was a meandering stream, but rejuvenation occurs, which returns the river system to incision, cutting downwards. If you look, if I remove that white squiggly line, now you can see these entrenched meanders. So what happened is there used to be a meandering stream going across the top of that landscape. But this is in the Grand Canyon, which is an area where the Colorado Plateau is bulging upwards. And as it does, it caused that meandering stream to incise, cut down into the landscape, making this steep-sided meandering canyon. The classic example of this is in Utah, where the San Juan River is incising the landscape, which you can see here, creating these fantastic entrenched meanders. These are really the classic. If you look at any physical geography textbook, any earth science textbook, any fluvial geomorphology textbook, this is going to show up. Here's another picture of it. Look at this. It's amazing. It's cutting down 2,000 feet into the landscape through all of that sedimentary strata. Just remarkable.